I'm here at NYU, where I want to thank Jay Wegman and want to welcome everybody to a place, an institution, where you can enroll and get a master in arts politics. We have some of the students in that department here, and Kathy Engel, who they have the luck of studying with in the audience. So thank you all. We are in exactly the right place, having exactly the right conversation. And I just want to admit at the beginning that there are some people I don't really want to be interdependent with. But we'll move on beyond that. Ben Barber was a real believer in change. He was a real believer. I remember him talking on my program. I host a TV show where we say it's the place where the people who say it can't be done take a back seat to the people who are doing it. And he was one of those people. He came in one day saying, you know, we have a 21st century problem and a 17th century nation state. These two will not meet. The 17th century institution of the nation state will never resolve the 21st century problem of global capital and global conflict, let alone all the many ways, in fact, we are interdependent. Ben believed, facing a challenge like that, that there was a solution, and that there was a solution within our reach. Funnily enough, he actually thought we could bring politicians together, mayors, and he did it all around the world. Mayors to talk about interdependence and how we connect, and to talk about the we that emerges as people all over the world try to deal with our interdependent problems in this globalized world. He believed that not only capital could be global, but we could too. And if politicians could do it, so too, even in this world of individuality and how many likes do you have, and how many followers do I have, and individual achievement and the commodification of absolutely everything, that artists could come together and change the world, and change each other, and change our experiences here on this planet. What we're going to bring together this evening are artists, and I want to thank Jackie and Rachel and Michael and Jay and everyone who's helped to bring this together, because we really have an extraordinary, I have the honor of introducing an extraordinary group of artists who are, in their own right, each one of them could be a stellar solo artist, and they are in many ways. But in fact, each of them brings into their work and will bring onto this stage a whole world, a world that they work with, that they live with, that they amplify, learn from, and allow us all to be inspired by in their work. These are the antipathy of the solo artist, but it's not quite right either. I'll introduce them all, and then what we will do is hear each of them talk a little bit about their work, and we will see a video, and then we will have a conversation, and then we have a performance coming from Anthony Arnov and the People's History crew to end out the evening. So let me introduce our panelists. Our panelists, Mohsin Mohiuddin is CEO and founder of MeWe International, which leverages the science of storytelling and communications as a tool for healing, building resilience, and community building, particularly in refugee communities. If you're not following his hashtag MeWeSyria, you should be. Mohsin, come on up. You're going to get the furthest seat. Ruchira Gupta is founder of the anti-trafficking organization APNAP, which serves more than 20,000 at-risk and prostituted girls and women and their family members. She's a journalist, a social activist, and a feminist campaigner, and she's been a visiting professor at NYU and a distinguished scholar at the University of California, Berkeley. Ruchira. Crystal Chanel Truscott has really her own mobile unit. Crystal is artistic director of Progress Theater, which is a touring ensemble about which we will hear more in a minute. She's currently a visiting professor at George Washington University, and she's the recipient most recently of a Doris Duke Award and a Creative Capital Award 2019. She's a playwright and much more. Crystal, come on up. And last but definitely not least, Arturo O'Farrell is artistic director and founder of the Afro-Latin Jazz Alliance, a nonprofit dedicated to the performance, education, and preservation of Afro-Latin music. He's a pianist, a composer, an educator. He recently organized the Fandango at the Wall, about which he'll tell us more. And he did tell me on my program. We'll hear more from Arturo in just a sec. Arturo O'Farrell, come on up. So let's start. Mohsen, you want to give us about 2.5 minutes of what you do, who you serve?
All right, 2.5 minutes. Thank you for the introduction. Hi, everybody. Assalamu alaikum. My name is Mohsen Mohideen. I want to start by just reading a quote by the great Martin Luther King. He says, "In a real sense, all life is interrelated. All men are caught in an inescapable network of mutuality, tied in a single garment of destiny. Whatever affects one directly affects all indirectly. I can never be what I ought to be until you are what you ought to be. This is the interrelated structure of reality." Martin Luther King. And I just read that this morning randomly, and I was like, shit, I'm gonna read that today. That's perfect. The key thing there for me is I can never be what I ought to be until you are what you ought to be. And what I feel he's really talking about there is identity. And when we talk about identity, what we're really talking about is a narrative of self. In my 10 years of working with hundreds and hundreds of youth in more than 15 countries, there is a huge problem and a danger that's happening with young people living as consequences and not living as choices. In MIWI, which is my organization, we believe that an arrested narrative of oneself translates to an arrested development of oneself. And in the spirit of interdependence, an arrested development of oneself translates to an arrested development of all of us, just like Martin Luther King talked about. Our theory of change in MIWI International is if you can reframe and express the stories you tell yourself about yourself, then you can strengthen your psychological well-being, you can exercise leadership opportunities, and you can set positive goals for the future. The stories we tell ourselves about ourselves shapes how we treat ourselves, and how we treat ourselves influences our relationship with the world around us. So in MIWI, what we have is actually an interconnected, interdependent methodology where we use storytelling communications in three ways. We support internal communication, which focuses on interoception and body awareness, understanding how your brain communicates with your gut, how your brain communicates with your heart, right? This is a therapeutic neuroeducation, which science is showing us actually helps people heal. Understanding this technology is more important than understanding this, right? And that's where healing and resilience can come from. So we focus on internal communication, focusing on interoception and body awareness, and then we move to interpersonal communication, talking with your friends and family, and then we go to public, which is where communicating for change making takes root. So I've been running this program on the border areas of Syria, on Turkey, Jordan, and Lebanon, and it's incredible because I'm not actually doing it. The way MIWI works, which is named after Muhammad Ali, who made MIWI famous, by the way, the great Muhammad Ali, what makes MIWI work is that we are training Syrian refugees to go through the program, taste the ice cream, and then talk about the ice cream in their own communities, yeah? So they're actually mobilizing and training young people in their own communities and entrepreneuring their own versions of MIWI. So we have MIWI Syria, we have MIWI Honduras, we have MIWI Mexico, MIWI Tajikistan, and MIWI Berlin, all over the place. So we're actually, they are cascading this knowledge where we're combining storytelling and neuroeducation and mental health and psychosocial support. They're cascading all of this knowledge between each other, and they're entrepreneuring their own versions of it, right? And a big component of MIWI, what we're seeing is it's impacting the refugees' goal setting, their perspective taking, their resilience assets. And the goal setting is a huge one, because in the words of Nietzsche, he who has a why can bear any how. And the first thing that happens in profound stress and trauma is that those networks of the brain that are associated with connectedness, goal setting, those get deserted, because you start to go in hyper-survival mode. You start to go in hyper-defensive mode, because all you're thinking about is survival and you're threatened all the time. And a lot of our brothers and sisters in these communities, that's imposed upon them. So they start to think that that's their reality, and that's why they start to think that they're a consequence and not a living choice. It's like someone having the control of the remote control of your brain, and you're not in control of it. Someone's pressing it forward and backward and rewind and pause and play. So we're trying to, through storytelling, we're seeing that it's having a real behavioral impact on these youth, and we've reached more than 1,000 people, and we're going to hit another 1,000 in the next 13 months.
You going to show us?
Yes, I'll show you right now. Thank you. Our hypothesis in MeWe, which is something I founded years ago, is an arrested narrative of oneself translates to an arrested development of oneself. What does an arrested development look like? It looks like communities of young people being unable to form goals. Communities of young people that when you ask them a question, they put their eyes down and they start to cry. Right? The world ain't going to get better if we're not reframing that for them. How can we flip the narrative and help them reclaim control of the narrative of themselves and of their lives? Stories for me are formulas for change.
Tonight's first person report.
MeWe Syria is a creative enterprise initiative that's completely led by young refugees who are passionate about being agents of change.
Action.
It's not coming out with a Hollywood quality video. It's about them actually practicing cognitive empathy. It's them practicing creative problem solving and working in teams.
How did your movie go today? How do you feel?
What I've seen in the prison, and what I've seen with ISIS, and after my family passed away, I didn't feel anything. I couldn't feel of people. But after the MeWe Syria trainings, I could feel of people, connect with them. And I found out that there is a peace in the world.
This program opened many things inside me and gave me too much hope that I've lost 5 years ago.
This program opened the spaces, creating the reality youth want.
مشروع من سوريا قدر يلمس واقع الشباب اللي عم بيعيشوا هلا بطريقه سهله وجميله. قدروا من خلاله يتذكروا الماضي ليستفيدوا منه بصناعه مستقبلهم، وبنفس الوقت ليكونوا فاعلين بمجتمعاتهم.
Beautiful. Thank you, Mohsin. Rishira.
Namaste. I'm from India, and I was a storyteller from age 9 or 10. I always wanted to tell the story. And slowly I began to want to tell the story and expose what was unfair. So I decided to become a journalist. And in my travels as a journalist, I was in villages of Nepal, where I found rows of villages with missing girls. And I began to ask the question, where are the girls? And the answer changed my life, because I found that there was a smooth supply chain from these villages in Nepal to the brothels of India. There were procurers, there were corrupt border guards, there were lodge keepers, there were transporters, there were pimps, brothel managers, landlords, organized criminal networks, and finally the sex buyers at the end of the whole chain, who were just consuming and consuming these little girls. And they were normally between the ages of 9 and 13. I did not know what to do. I was a woman, I was young, it was my country, my world, my generation. And it looked like slavery to me, what I found. So I decided to tell the story, ended up making a documentary called The Selling of Innocence. And that was a life-changing experience for me, because I spent so much time inside the brothels listening. Because part of storytelling is also story listening. And I heard the women, and I had never heard this kind of exploitation ever in my life. As a journalist, I'd covered war and famine and hunger and caste conflict and other things in India. But I had never seen this kind of deliberate exploitation of one human being by another. So I won an Emmy for Selling of Innocence, but I didn't want to stay a journalist because I thought journalism was limiting. And I decided to do something about it. So with the women who told their stories in my documentary, I started a small not-for-profit just with 22 women. And these were the women, in fact, who had rescued me while I was filming, because someone had pulled out a knife at me saying, we will not let you film inside the brothels. And these women had formed a circle around me and said that, no, we want her to tell our story, and if you want to kill her, you've got to kill us first. And the man slunk away thinking it would be too much trouble to kill 23 women. Mm-hmm. So with these 22 women, I started a small not-for-profit called Apne Aap, which means self-action in Hindi. And I was a journalist, so I didn't have a law degree. I wasn't a doctor. I wasn't a social worker. So really, I didn't know what to do. But we sat in a circle, and we decided we would talk to each other and figure things out. And at that time, the women said they had four dreams. They wanted a school for their children. They wanted a job in an office for themselves. And if you saw where they lived in the chawls of Bombay, it was rat infested, 20 rooms to one toilet, one narrow staircase going up, iron bars in the window, 10 or 15 customers a night, children playing on the floor while the women had to serve the customers, smell of stench and sweat and poverty all around. You could just smell it, the dried sperm, I used to think it was. I don't even know what it was. But stale air in those rooms, because they were always being used by customers. And so I asked them, so their second dream was they wanted a job in an office. And I could not imagine what a job in an office meant to those women, because we were sitting in these hell holes, and I was sure their imagination had been cut off. And they said something which has lots of air and light, and where we will not be yelled at and screamed at or beaten, where we will have fixed working hours and old age pension. And I thought, yes, of course, and a monthly income, a steady monthly income. Like all of us, they wanted a job in an office. And the third thing, their dream was, they said they wanted their own place, a room of their own. And I was an English literature student, and I couldn't believe I was listening to Virginia Woolf in a brothel in Bombay. And I said, what do you mean by a room of your own? And they said something just this big, and they stretched out their arms wide. And they said, you know, where we can sleep peacefully, because in a brothel, a customer can walk in night or day, and you have to be sexually available. So many of the women suffered from insomnia. And they said, where our children can be safe, because the customers would often reach out for the children when they came to visit the women. And they said, we'll even stop drinking alcohol if we get a room of our own. And the fourth dream they had was justice. And again, I couldn't understand what could justice mean in this situation where customers were just coming constantly, raping them, the pimps and the brothel keepers were keeping the money, you know, the children were held hostage, customers were stubbing out cigarette butts on them, bottles up their vaginas. You know, there was just didn't seem any meaning to justice. So they said, well, there was nobody to watch out for us when we were pulled out of school and put into a brothel, because they were normally between the ages of 9 and 13 when they were brought into these brothels. And the youngest I have met is a 7-year-old. So they said, if somebody had been there to protect us, this wouldn't have happened. Or when we even tried to run away from the brothel, the police often sent us back saying, this is your life. So justice to them meant protection, but also what it meant was that it meant accountability. They said that they wanted those who had bought them and sold them to be punished severely. So based on those four dreams became our business plan, and we started by renting a little room in a red light area and started educating the children. Once the children were ready for school, the women who had formed the circle with me, we formed the principle of circles again and again and went to the principal as a group and begged and pleaded, and the principal relented, children were admitted to school. And fast forward, you know, what Laura spoke about, now we have branches all across India among different red light districts, including in some caste communities that are suffering from intergenerational prostitution, that is prostitution passed down from mother to daughter, because long ago under British colonialism, these communities were labeled as criminal tribes simply for being nomadic. And all these years I've continued to tell the story, but sometimes I feel that not telling the story on behalf of someone is fine, but unless the women and the children start telling their own stories, nobody is going to believe them. And so we started our own newspaper called Red Light Dispatch, in which the women dictated their stories if they could not read or write, and other people who could wrote down their stories. And these stories became important because a woman in a brothel in Calcutta would think that, would understand that a woman in a brothel in a village in Bihar was suffering from the same circumstances and same discrimination based on a system. And she began to understand that she was not crazy, but the system was crazy. So that created a solidarity, and it gave voice to the voiceless, but it also gave strength to the women who were speaking up so they could actually transform the top. Because, you know, as Oscar said, democracy begins at the bottom and transforms the top. So literally after the Jyoti Singh Pandey rape happened, you know, the bus rape, which you all have heard about, our women marched outside parliament and said prostitution is commercial rape. They went and testified to the committee set up. They went and met political leaders. And these were women who had been silenced and subjugated for so long, but they found their voice. And they asked for stricter laws on sexual assaults for all women. And that's how the law changed. The largest numbers were the women from Apne Aap. And you know, what I also found was that the healing of storytelling, because many of the women themselves had been obliterated. You know, remember they were 9 or 10 or 11 or 12 when they were pulled into the brothels. And then every night, 8 or 10 customers would rape them. So, for example, one woman told me that her favorite color was black. And I asked her, why black? And she said, you know, because when I shut my eyes, I see black when a customer is on top of me. So it's my favorite color. And by articulating that and by storytelling, we used to do open mic sessions, writing for red light dispatches, then slowly starting to speak to authorities, then in big public rallies, then to political leaders, the women found that they had a story to tell. Their sense of self had been so obliterated that they had no idea that they were worth even having a story. And that also helped them put together a coherent narrative of what had happened to them, which also helped us to speak up in court and put traffickers in jail, besides changing laws. So it helped in so many ways. And now, of course, there's a video here which will sort of show you the kind of work I'm doing.
I promise.
In 1998, I saw Ruchira's award-winning film, The Selling of Innocence, which is an expose of the flesh trade. She made the film after she visited Himalayan villages and noticed they were emptied of women between the ages of 15 and 45. Ruchira started a center called Apne Aap, which means on our own in Hindi. With that, she crossed the line from journalist to activist.
My house.
Your house?
Yeah. Bedroom? kitchen, AC.
AC.
We try to build self-esteem through music and dance, and that goes a long way. But then we come to a dead end at one point when the girls turn 13 or 14, just at puberty, because we know that the brothel madams are going to put them into a prostitution. But the girl in the green dress, Naseem, hasn't been in the business as yet. She was somehow protected because the brothel madam liked her a lot, and she thought that she could get more out of her when she grew older. She was kind of skinny. And I was telling the madam that she wants to be a doctor, let her stay and study on for another year or 2 years. I was literally trying to buy time. So I had to sit and negotiate and negotiate and negotiate, and finally the madam has agreed to give us one more year. What we want to do is actually eradicate sex trafficking and the exploitation inside prostitution.
Has your spirit changed since you sort of moved from journalist to activist?
Yes, because as a journalist, you go so far and then you back off. You know, you don't want the responsibility of changing the world. But as an activist, you go, you push and you push and you push till you feel that you've actually got a paradigm shift.
The village girls sold into sex slavery are victims. But with support and voice, they aren't powerless. And Ruchira would never call herself a warrior, but she is one.
Crystal.
Really grateful to be sharing the stage with you all and to be here. I like to start every occasion that I have to speak with the group by inviting what I call to be like the first lesson of community engagement and connection and our interdependency, which we're talking and thinking and dreaming about tonight, which is call and response. And what that means for me in a really simple way as a Black woman from the South is that if I say something to you, if I call to you, you respond. So can we just have a moment of connection? Good evening.
Good evening.
There you go. So that's our the performance I'd like to start with. So I create what I call neo-spirituals, and they are a cappella musical theater in the tradition of Negro spirituals, field songs, and all of their aesthetic descendants, right? So jazz, blues, gospel, R&B, hip-hop, spoken word, all of these things. And my company has been doing this work for about 20 years. We started as undergraduate students just a stone's throw at Tisch School of the Arts and have been touring ever since with this work called neo-spirituals, using in particular a method that I call soul work, which is developed from generations-old performance traditions rooted in African-American aesthetics and traditions. And one of the things, I mean, one of the gifts of brilliance that comes from really studying what it means, what it meant for people to create works of art, coming from that lineage, is that people were creating in the spirit of aspiration, which means that they were constantly dreaming forward toward a reality that they weren't experiencing, right? So people were writing and singing and moving and reaching and hoping for freedom even as they were being denied it at every turn, often, you know, violently and systemically. So this tradition that I inherited really pushed me to think about what it meant to use art to radically reimagine the circumstances in which we are in and dream toward the future. How to create safer and braver spaces for people to come together and imagine this. And I use the word safer and braver, not safe and not brave, because again, the spirit of aspiration and that we can always improve, and that the fact is that, you know, no space is going to be or should be safe for everybody, right? And sometimes our level of braveness one day, hopefully we can top it the day going forward. So this idea of an unending climax where you're constantly reaching in that way. So soul work, part of soul work, it is a devising and generative method that involves acting, writing, singing, movement, all of these things. But as a community engagement practice, it really creates space and experience for people to vulnerably engage, interrogate, explore, and discover. where a lot of community engagement work, I think, which is good work, focuses on grappling with the present and the past, frequently absent is this critical step of envisioning and practicing new ways of being for the future. And so I often like to enact this idea of community engagement as rehearsal, right? As rehearsing the society that we want to be and the ways that we want to be connected, a focus on collective and collaborative future building. The past few years, I've been really neck deep. I started to say knee deep, and I was like, that ain't true. You know, I was neck deep in a project called Plantation Remix that I'm working on, which is a site-responsive a cappella musical, a neo-spiritual, that will take place on historic plantation sites, and I would say plantation-adjacent sites as well, things that are connected to plantation legacy, to really, on one hand, rehabilitate and reimagine this industry of historical tourism and plantation tourism. What does it mean to tell the story of a site with multiple voices as opposed to the single story voice, which in the case of plantations is oftentimes this sort of Disney princess antebellum version of slavery in the South, but also to really empower the community to become stewards of these artifacts and change them from artifacts to living sites that actually contribute to this future building. So it's one of the questions at the heart of it is, what is an appropriate afterlife for sites of trauma? What is an appropriate afterlife for these spaces, and how can we imagine them? So we're currently in a stage of the development process. You know, as we were researching and writing the piece, what has come to be is that about 50 to 60% of it is the same as we go from plantation to plantation. But what, of course, wouldn't make any sense for it to all be the same, because the sites are so different and they hold so much different energy and histories and community stewardship. And so the rest of the piece is devised with the community that lives in connection to the site. And so in exploring and doing this, I hold a series of what I call community collaboratives that recruits and invites people in the community to come and be a part of the devising process. And the dream and what has happened so far is that we have people coming who are neighbors but didn't know it, you know, are neighbors but who've never engaged, are people in all of these ways. And then they are thrown into a creative process. So I'll pause there and share the video. One of the things that I love about this video, because it's not the best quality video, but it gives you kind of a fly on the wall view of this moment, the spark of when the start of community building, the start of this interconnectedness, this interdependency. Because the sound can be a little shaky in some spaces, I just want to tell you what to look out for. Two of my favorite things. One is just that even if it was on mute, the configuration and structure of the room and people's bodies and the way that they interconnect is one of my favorite things to watch in this video. And then that the makeup of the people in the space in terms of, you know, cross-generational, cross-cultural, cross-class, cross-gender, all of these things were things that we were just really, really proud of. And I remember someone asking, well, how do you think you're going to build this diverse community ensemble? I said, well, I'm going to invite people. You know, and sure enough, that's what happens if you start there. So there are three parts to this workshop that have been condensed into the three minutes that you'll see, but that it starts with this song sharing. So some song that is in the public domain or that it kind of lives in the heart of the community. And if that particular community hasn't offered us one, then we'll bring one. A song sharing, and then it goes into this call and response that I call the collaborative remix, where everyone in the community is invited to pull out a piece of the song that means something to them and share it back. And then in this remix, the song itself, the third part is where the remix becomes cipher, which means that the song that we've started with, the community has then created something new. So they've built something new for the future that will ultimately end up being a part of the show in some way. So I'll stop there and we'll watch a little bit of community happening.
What it means to have have freedom singing at the heart of how we're using our voices, right? So we're not meant to be a choir, right? We're meant to live in the essence of the word. So that first sentence is what?
We are solid as a rock.
Hello? Right? So everybody say, where is it? We are solid.
We are solid.
We are solid.
We are solid.
Speak it. We are solid.
We are solid.
Good. Go.
We are solid as a rock.
We are solid as a rock.
Better. Rooted like a tree.
We are rooted like a tree.
We are here.
We are here.
Standing strong.
Standing strong.
We are solid.
Go.
Tree. We are solid. We are solid.
We are solid.
Solid. Without her gestures.
We are solid. We are solid.
Do what you want. Listen to each other.
Okay, how to begin as a jazz musician becoming somebody who's an agent of change sounds weird, but I'm not an agent of change, I'm really a malcontent. I'm actually also transcultural and musically deviant. I am straight, I am gay, I am male, I am female, I am Mexican, I'm American. I am so many things, and I see that that's the real problem with our lives, is that we see ourselves in divisions. And so I want to tell you a quick story about something that happened 6 or 7 months ago. I was in Kuwait. I was doing some research for a concert I did in Abu Dhabi called The Middle Eastern Roots of Afro-Cuban Jazz. Remember, you heard it here first. And I'm sitting down at the person's home, and the gentleman who invited me says, well, Mr. O'Farrell would like to do this concert here, and he's going to tell you about this. And I said, yes, well, we are all connected and rooted in each other, and especially because we were all descendants of Africa. And the biggest brother in the room looked at me and went, you don't look African. So already I knew I was in for an interesting evening. So I said, bet, teach me some of your rhythms. So they began to teach me a Kuwaiti clay pot rhythm, and I started playing along with them. And after a while, he looked at me and said, how'd you learn our music? And I said, well, let me teach you a mambo. And so I taught him a mambo called Havana Blues, and it goes from a mambo to a wawancoa, which is a slower rhythm, to a faster rhythm. And he was just, they're having a great time. And I'm accompanying them at the piano. And I'm looking at the piano, and they're all squatting. And I'm going, well, this is not right. This is completely incorrect. So out of the corner of my eye, I spot a little red toy piano. So I sit down, I squat with them, I get in front of the little red toy piano, and we begin to jam. And this hierarchicalization, this actual height difference, was keeping us apart. Not only was the culture, the music, the rhythm, all was inherently inside of us, but unless we break down walls we don't understand, then we're including height. So I sit down on the floor, squatting, and I start playing the little red toy piano, and all of a sudden everybody's screaming and yelling. And then the next thing I knew, I'm starting to use the little red toy piano like a percussion device. At which point the brother looks at me and he starts to smile. He grabs my skin and he goes, "Well, you're black, but your skin is white." And I look at him and I said, "Man, it's just a shell. It's just a shell." I created the Afro-Latin jazz lines because I was a malcontent. I thought being a jazz musician was only going to be that meaningful. How good can you play? How fast can you play? How famous can you get? Jazz and fame? And then I connected something in my brain. I thought there's a way to connect your art to real cause. And I saw and created an organization that is not just, we don't just perform. We have school residencies. We go into 16 New York City marginalized city schools serving 2,000 children with 35, 50 teaching artists. We have a program called GRIO, Global Rhythms in Our Tribes, which is an after-school program, but secretly it's an anti-gun violence program. We have we use every tool that we have. And what I'm going to show you now is the tool that I hate to say I came up with these things. I didn't come up with these things. They're just things that had to be done. And I had the good fortune to see people and connect them. And this thing that we are about to see is about a group of people that get together every year at the border between Tijuana and San Diego, and they jam. Some of these people are related and have really physically touched in decades, but they sit at the border itself, at the wall, and dance and sing to each other. And it's amazing to see physical reality destroyed by spirit and community and conscience. And it's an incredible thing that I was able to witness this, that I was able to play a part in it is even bigger. But I think that these folks are elegant activists that show us the true currency we have is each other. You can play it now.
Amor sin fronteras.
This all started when I read about a wizard who was changing physical matter itself with the music of Fandango.
Que viva México!
Gathered his friends at the border to sing, perform, and dance. And that wall, built to divide us, was transformed into something that unites us.
Tarima y tumba y cajón, ¿de dónde viene tu encanto? Tarima, tumba y cajón. ¿De dónde viene tu encanto? Me viene del corazón, del monte sereno y santo. Me viene del corazón, del monte sereno y santo.
I fell in love with this idea of people coming together, using that primal connection of music and culture to destroy barriers and remove borders.
Tarima tumba y cajón, de donde viene tu encanto. Tarima tumba y cajón, de donde viene tu encanto. Me viene del corazón, del monte sereno y santo. Me viene del corazón, del monte sereno y santo. Tarima tumba y cajón, de donde viene.
People have been gathered from every corner of the earth. People who have never met, to these studios, to this border, for this cause. This is not just a story, but it's also a fight for survival.
¿Quién dijo que habías perdido tu dignidad y tu historia? ¿Quién dijo que tu memoria tan solo es polvo y olvido? Despierta, despierta, patria, despierta. Despierta, patria, despierta. Despierta, patria, despierta. Despierta, patria, despierta. Despierta, patria, despierta.
The sign of the Fandango, the Fandango doctrine.
Thank you all. You can tell we can have a whole, that's what you can do through the wall. Get it? Yeah, got it. We could talk clearly for a long time, but when we spoke earlier, we spoke just briefly, the overwhelming desire of the people on this panel was to be practical. Was to talk about how to do this work. And so I want to start there because time is always short. And I want to really appreciate the degree to which each of your videos start the conversation of how do you do it. And ask you to elaborate a little bit on how do you create the atmosphere of sharing, of connection in places and with people for whom that doesn't come automatically, necessarily. You talk, Ruchira, in your work about assets-based development and thinking, and in a way you all talk about it, about what exists that we can draw on that maybe we haven't been drawing on. But how do you do it in places that often feel pretty bleak and discouraged and you get a lot of blank stares, or maybe you don't?
I look around and try to see what exists and you know, first of all, try to create a safe space for the people who have to tell the stories and try to figure out what does that mean. And it could be a mud hut in a brothel district. It could be a straw mat on the floor in a park just next to a brothel. And from there, we try to build courage among each other. So I have to tell the story myself first. And sometimes I've shared things with the women, which I haven't shared with my friends or family, but I try to be as honest as possible and respect silence and listen. Because otherwise it doesn't work. And to look, you know, in India, we in poor areas, we don't have psychiatrists and counselors. So we have to begin with healing and speaking. We have to find a different mechanism for healing. And the healing comes from being with each other, feeling safe, speaking up and articulating a story. But it also comes from the fact that there are people listening. I think that is so important. And you have to go, exactly what Oscar said, that you have to go where people are. You know, if you want people to come to you, you have to go to them.
You're nodding, Arturo.
Yeah, no, I know exactly what you're saying. We, you know, we had a concert series, the mandate was to bring people into the arts, and I said, that's crazy. we don't, you know, we actually set up concerts with Baba Israel in bodegas in the Bronx and in the Longwood laundromat and in barbershops and just bring art there because it's where it belongs and that's where it really is most needed. And learn just going to people and just pick up a mission, say, I'm going to teach that kid. I'm going to go into that school. I'm going to go into that prison. That's what we did. That's how I created it. I just said, I want to go into the schools. I went to a school and said, let me teach. I went to a prison and said, let me visit. Let me teach music to these people and just do it. Mm. Just do it and move. Move.
Well, there's so many, because this is the first time we're actually hanging out, not on a phone call, so I'm just learning so much from you guys, so thank you. It's a really important question you ask, Laura, and for us, we set a frame in the beginning, we call it a frame up, and you know the power of stories are it can take you from where you are to where you want to be. It's a vehicle. So we're getting in this car together, and that's where we're trying to go. And let's define what that is. And we give them some seeds for that. And the first one is curiosity above fear. Curiosity above fear. Because that is the first step towards healing. If you are afraid of yourself, and if you are afraid of the stories flowing inside of you, then your chances for interconnectedness or connectedness with anyone around you severely diminish. And this is also neurologically speaking as well, with your body. The second is passion above perfection. Yeah. Okay? So basically, like, fuck up and as much as you can, and don't be ashamed of making mistakes. Because the first thing is a lot of these kids feel like they are a mistake, the kids that I work with. So no innovation, no imagination, like, don't do that because you might make a mistake or you're going to feel ashamed or you should feel guilty. I think those things are really important. And the other aspect of how we always start our program is we start with eye contact. The first thing we have them do is draw portraits of one another. These people haven't met before. These are refugees that are in the community, but they don't know each other. Mm. So we have them sit and just draw each other. And always what happens is the first time they draw one another, they're not looking at each other. Do it again. Okay, the second time they do it, find a detail. Mm. And this, to answer your question, it's about energy. Mm. Communication is about energy, and energy comes from eye contact. It comes from feeling your body. It comes from feeling the energy of someone else. That's what empathy is, man. It's energy. That's what storytelling is. It's energy. It's a transference of energy.
Crystal.
Yeah, I would echo a lot of what has been said in our individual remarks and even now. I mean, I think, Rashir, you started by saying you start by listening. Yeah. And, you know, for a lot of theater producers, the touring model of my company frustrates them because I don't perform in a community unless I've met the community. Oh. Unless I've been there and I know what's happening, I meet the people and I learn from the people, which means that, you know, folks gotta pay to bring you out more than once, you know, so that you can connect and do all of those things, because the goal is that real connection. But, I mean, it's simple as it sounds, that invitation, that good morning, that good evening, that good afternoon, that I see you, you know, that listening opens so many doors. It's really quite simple. Like, there's not a lot of mystery to it. But the other thing that I'll say is that, and her name is escaping me right now, so forgive me, but a woman who was the director of the Free Street Theater in Chicago said something once when we were talking, having this conversation about what it means to preach to the choir. And she said, well, choirs need preachers. Yeah. And I said, well, you know, this is so true. I do a cappella musicals in 5-part harmony, so I'm like all about like the dynamics of choir, right? And the thing is that when you have a choir, even if you, especially a community choir, you have some folks who, are at the beginning of their journey to understanding rhythm or understanding polyrhythm. Like, they're in the room, they want to be in the choir, but they can only be on one beat. You know, you have folks who get the polyrhythm. You have people who can hear harmony and people who can only do unison. So even you have this choir, just like, you know, literally and figuratively, of people who want to be in the room and are still trying to learn how to be in the room. So I also say, you know, I cultivate my choir. I cultivate my choir because the thing is that that person who maybe came in the room not being able to hear harmony or not being able to hear the polyrhythm, they know someone who doesn't even want to be in the choir. And they may have a better chance of bringing that person into the room and into the contagion of this energy, of the connection, of the empathy than I would, right? So just don't underestimate the invitations that I can't give or I can't give as effectively. But I cultivate my choir and then, you know, really do the work of building these ripples or these concentric circles where people can reach the places that I can't reach and bring them into the choir based off of what they know.
Is that how you're thinking about interdependence? I mean, clearly the call and response is an interdependent relationship. Does it come up in other ways in your work, Crystal?
Yeah, I mean, I think the thing is that we are interdependent and interconnected whether we acknowledge it or not, right? And so the problem is not that that doesn't exist. The problem is that we are struggling to express that through emotional connection, through transformation, and through an investment in each other's wellness. And so this is, you know, what I mean when I say that we do the work that, you know, before coming into the community. And then with this particular piece, so like these folks that you saw, these are folks who now have their own ensemble, right? They exist without us. And so the other thing that's important for me is that, as a touring artist, is that wherever I go, that there is something that lives on, that what we've collaborated with the community with, that continues, and that is, I don't have to be involved with it, but I'm forever connected to it, you know, and so once the community has tapped into their own interdependency or their connection, you know, like the multitude of things that they can create and do and manifest just continues to multiply.
And you talked about that, doing that same thing in your work, creating these hubs, Mohsen.
Right, yeah, so it's the same exact, that was beautiful about you. I can't say it better than that, but we're not, first of all, storytelling the arts, they're butchered to death, okay? When it's not enough to give a kid a camera in a refugee camp and then pat yourself on the back and say, you took a picture. No. It's, you have to push the boundaries. You have to give them, you have to basically admit that you know nothing and give them the camera, give them the methodology, and give them everything to entrepreneur on their own, putting the last first. And that's painful to do, especially if you built something and you put your blood and sweat and as activists, your heart and soul into it. But that's one of the biggest challenges, but it's also one of the most beautiful things, because now we have 60 trained Syrian refugees who are living as refugees in the most unstable situations, who are reaching thousands of young people in their own community. They're learning about mental health, psychosocial support. They're learning about, you know, neuroeducation. They're learning about communications, and they're cascading it down on their own. So just like you, like, I haven't met these people. I just know the people we've trained. And I think that's so crucial, but it's also painful because you have to let go, and it starts to turn into something that maybe you didn't think it would turn into or not want to, but that doesn't matter, man, because you learn from it. Because we started out as actually a music program in Morocco. And then the kids literally were snorting drugs during the music therapy sessions. But then when they actually started to record their music so they could listen to it later and show their friends on the street, like on a laptop, and then you left the laptop with them, and then you let them write their own songs and narratives, and then it's like you step back and back, and it becomes this crazy, beautiful thing. So I think leaving them with the tools and trusting them with these methodologies and letting it morph into something else is also part of interdependence too, is letting go.
Bashira, you have a very concrete example of interdependence globally and making change.
That's right. You know, because there's one part of my work which is about interconnection, to make people realize they're interconnected, the rich with the poor and the men with women and across borders and boundaries. And one challenge I had when I began working on sex trafficking in India was that I wasn't able to change the laws, and the police would still go and arrest the women and let the clients go scot-free. So I needed to change the law, but every time I would go to a police officer, he would say, no, these are bad women and prostitution is as old as the hills, and if prostitutes don't exist, then men will rape good women, quote unquote. So I thought, you know, how am I going to do this? And I had a film, I had a story to tell. I had made The Selling of Innocence, it had won an Emmy. So I thought, okay, I'm going to target the two centers of power that I know, the UN and the US government. So I came to America, and with the help of, a long time ago, with the help of the Clintons, they were in the White House. The film was shown at the UN, and it began the process of creating a UN protocol in which we actually shifted the blame from the victim to the perpetrator, so addressed the demand for trafficking. And that became the norm for all countries to change their laws. And at the same time, I went to the US Senate and testified for a bipartisan bill, which is now the trafficking law in the US, showing the selling of innocence. So I took the voices of survivors of prostitution from India and created the first law in the US on trafficking. And that was interdependence to me. And then use that law and the UN protocol to influence a change of law in my own country. So, and people began to see that there was interdependence because they began to understand that there were stories which were similar. Because when I took the law to the UN or to the US government, I had NGOs from the US who came and spoke up about their experiences. And I could not have done it alone, and they couldn't have done it alone. So we are so interconnected.
We don't have a lot of time left, but I want to get super practical on one level, which is how does any of this work get paid for? And then another question I have is around commodification and co-optation. In a period where everyone's individual story now can be their asset, how do we keep alive a culture of exchange and sharing and call and response that isn't about necessarily a financial exchange? So you can take one of those questions in either order. But how do you fund it, and then how do you make it all not about money? Easy question.
I mean, I would just from our experience, the grants are very difficult sometimes to get, sometimes easy, and you have to diversify your funding, and you have to really have people that are willing to not depend on one source, individuals or foundations. You have to really constantly invent, and you have to constantly be willing. There's a level of commodification in all of it. You have to have revenue streams from these activities to support the times when you're not being granted. But I think where there's a spirit, there's a way. You find a way. We fight every single day, underpaid, overworked, tired, exhausted, but we fight every single day to find different ways and models and just keep moving and making, and I guess we talked about this during the phone call, but if we have anything that we can do here is to get somebody out there going, I can do that. I can find funding. I can change the world. Somebody out there right now, right at this very moment, is thinking, wow, what do I have to do? Just do it, man. Just get out there and make that change, because it's a vital, necessary component of who we are.
I'll start with the how does it not become a commodity is the question, and just really leaning into your MeWe, with this current project I'm working on with Plantation Remix, one of the first questions was, how do we enter the space? Who gets to enter the space? And what do we do once we're there? And then we started talking about the we. And one of the first things that came up is that, well, what we know first is that we cannot start the story with this land being a plantation, because this land had a life and had people and had, soul, right, beforehand. So there was already a crime that happened against the land in taking land away from Native and Indigenous people before even the system of slavery came. So you had land that was already traumatized and holding all of this. And then the second crime came on top of it. So that if the story, for one, starts there, I mean, just in terms of this interconnectedness, right, of how does it not become, it's not a story that we can tell alone. Right, so we start with this first crime, and then we start with all of the descendants of the system of slavery, and then we think about the systemic descendants of slavery, right? Susan Laurie Parks has a line where she says, there's not a person that lives in or moves through America that is not impacted by the legacy of the system of slavery, right? So in some ways, that's a really practical thing. One of the sites that we're working at, Monticello, has an annual citizenship naturalization ceremony, right? So you have people that their very entry point into becoming American happens on the ground of this, you know, site that has layers and layers of trauma. But the more people have the opportunity to be in space and realize that there really is no story that can be told alone, that there's always going to be the multiple story, I think is really the thing that pulls back from this idea of how does it become something that is commercial. It can't happen unless we're all there, or as many people as we can get into the space are there.
You know, I'll start with the commodification answer first, because, you know, the women I work with are so commodified. And on one hand, there's the binary of the seller and the sold. But sometimes with the women that I work with, the binary merges because the seller and the sold become the same. And there's such a sense of alienation with the women, you know, from their own selves sometimes that I work with. So I've had to struggle with that a lot. That how can one overcome that and you know, decommodify oneself in that process? And that is really finding your soul, as you were talking about. It's so vital, like the voice, the soul, the body. And one of the strategies I use is like karate and dance, which you saw, because once you begin to love your body, then you begin to think of your mind, connect with things around you. But also in terms of the interdependence of the woman with a girl in a 13-year-old in a village in Nepal or in a brothel in Bombay, with that person who's on the Upper East Side, who has a lot of money or in a mansion somewhere, how do I make them realize that there's something which binds them together is harder? Because very often I'll be told, oh, it's a choice, you know, and why do you even want to work on this issue? And, you know, so I have to explain that it's actually prostitution is absence of choice. Or, you know, what if we have a whole Me Too campaign in America, but what if being sexually harassed is the job itself? What do you do in that circumstance? So I have to look for language, vocabulary, connect circumstances together to create a sense of interdependence. Because how do you create interdependence between the powerless and the powerful? And sometimes also, you know, like the women say that we don't want to tell our stories again and again. You know, they feel like commodities even to tell their stories after there's been some kind of consciousness raising. And so I have to tell them that, can you think how tired I am of telling your story again and again? You know, I have to tell my own story and then all your stories collectively. Mm-hmm. So it's hard. It's very, very hard. And in terms of funding, you know, it's a struggle. It's always a struggle. And I've always tried to find different revenue streams like writing or teaching, or so that I'm not dependent on just a donor, but it's never enough. It's never enough.
Molson, I want you to answer the question, but I want you also to talk about a practice that I think you and I share. We've taken on my program to asking everybody on the program, what is the story the future will tell about this moment? And you do something similar.
Yeah.
So I don't want to deny you the right to talk about money, but I do want you to talk about that practice, and maybe each of us reflect as we close a little on what do we think is the story the future will tell about now.
Yeah, well, screw the money. We can talk about that later. So what Lara's referring to is we have an exercise called the Future to Present, which is a goal-setting exercise. This is where communications and storytelling really goes into towards like a psychological pedagogy, you know, communications towards a goal and rewiring your brain to envision a goal and to try and attain it and create steps and finish what you start. And in the Future to Present exercise, we have the Syrian brothers and sisters at the very end of the program write themselves a narrative from the perspective of 5 or 10 years into the future to themselves now. So they would write, you know, from, you know, 20, 30 to now. And what would they say? You know, what's changed? What does it smell like? What do things look like? What do people's energies and emotions look like? What stayed the same? How'd you get there? What were the steps to get there?
what to look out for. And after they write it, they share it with one another. This is the interpersonal part. And when they share it with one another, what starts to happen is perspective taking, which is another part of our psychological pedagogy, which is what communications and storytelling does. So they start to take in different perspectives. I feel that way too, but I would handle that differently. I would do this. And then they start to create alternative solutions, start to problem solve. And then we have them video blog it. So they look at themselves on the screen, and many of them for the first time. And they create a video blog of themselves from the future talking to themselves now. And you can imagine that's a pretty profound experience, especially for the sisters, the mothers, and the young girls who have never, you know this, they've never touched or pushed a button. They've never pushed a button, okay? Doesn't that sound insane? And can you imagine, like, every time we do this exercise, especially for the sisters in our program, when they push that record button, it's like they're detonating all the walls inside of them that have been preventing them from telling their narrative and reauthoring it, reframing it, redefining it. And I'm not in the theater realm of things, but from what I'm hearing is that in the process of acting something out, you're there. You know, reality and imagination start to become one in your brain, and you're actually there. And in the future present exercise, the goal becomes real. So it's pretty profound, and I can share the videos with you guys at any point. But I think the future to present, what I would say now, is if I'm speaking to you, beautiful people, I would say be gentle with yourself. Okay, be gentle with yourself. And expect to fail. And don't be afraid to piss people off if you're trying to change things, and disappoint people if you're trying to change things. And that's all part of the process. And to always put passion above perfection and curiosity above fear. That's what I would say. And at this moment in history, our world is on fire. And if we are not talking about our own inner technology and how to be aware of it and how to use it more properly, not on Facebook or Instagram, but this, something a machine cannot replace. If we don't work on that, then we're gonna continue to have this in-group and out-group empathy that there's a lot of research going about. We're great on Facebook about connecting with people that have similar likes than us. When we start talking with that person likes Trump and this person liked Hillary, they're not talking to each other. We have to break that barrier between in-group empathy and out-group empathy, and that's communication. That's why we need communication.
Do we manage it? What does the future tell? What's the story the future tells about now? Do we do it?
I'm not sure. I know one of the things that I've learned, if I could look back and tell myself anything, it would be that it's not about you. Don't take it personally. If you have a vision and a goal, and you allow that your ego and kind of your personal offense at the things that you need to do to get to achieve what you see as a vision, you'll never get there. You'll never get there because it's so easy to be discouraged, and it's so easy to be hurt in the process. And especially, as you said, that you're going to draw a lot of fire, because whenever you stand up for anything, there will be people who will be haters, and that's okay. But you have to learn to disassociate. And I think it's really important to disassociate from that mission and just achieve it because it's the right thing to do, not because you're personally invested in feeling good or bad about yourself.
Will the future say that we ended trafficking?
I'm sure, just like we ended slavery, right? And there will be strands of it right now. But we did end slavery, so I think the future will say that. But I think what's more important, what the future will say, is that a group of people were sitting on stage in the middle of a time which was very much like 1933 Germany, when fascism was crawling and creeping into our world. And we were talking about interdependence, and we won.
Ohala. Top that, Crystal.
That's hard to top. I would amen that. But I think I would say we began in urgency and we continue in urgency. Toni Morrison has a line in her novel, Love, that says, I dream a dream that dreams back at me. And so I like this idea of, like, as we are pulling from what came, we are dreaming it forward, and they will do the same for us, and pulling what came, and then they will dream it forward. But there's this unending climax that is always in urgency, you know? And so that's where we are.
Beautiful. Thank you all. Incredible. Arturo, Crystal, Ruchira, Mohsen.